Hey everyone, Shabby Game here, and welcome back to Mayhem here in our SWE universe. This is going to be our first episode after our SWE Beginnings 5-night pay-per-view. It is live here from Providence, Rhode Island. Got it. I actually got one. Alright, looks like we're going to start things off with AJ Styles coming down to the ring. Then at the best of times in the King of Gladiators tournament, I keep forgetting what it's called now, the King of Gladiators, I think it was, he got knocked out in the semi-finals by Roderick Strong, didn't he? So, interesting to see what AJ Styles got in his mind here. He's missed out on an opportunity to get that guaranteed matchup against Samoa Joe at Shabby Mania. Of course, the red pay-per-view suggested by Tony Wilson. You all know how unpredictable I can be, and tonight is no different. I'm in a mood to shake things up, and tonight I'd like to help a certain superstar to make this special, and that superstar is Finn Balor. Okay. What's AJ got in mind here? Calling Finn Balor to the ring. And here comes Finn Balor, I think. Where is he? It's just merged through the lighting rig there. Okay, well, entrances on this sort of thing don't seem to be too fluent, do they, really? Oh, I think you just love this game. Oh, well, it doesn't make a difference, does it? So AJ Styles calling out Finn Balor. Assuming, I'd say AJ didn't do too bad. He got to the semi-finals in the King of Gladiators tournament, so I'm sure he can still try and get himself something. Maybe looking to make a statement here against Finn Balor, maybe? Well, you've definitely got my attention. I'm wondering what you've got to say. But knowing you, it's got to be good, or at least interesting. So let's hear it. Okay. So AJ has got to say. Two is greater than one. It's basic match. No, it's basic math, I think you'll find. I know you get it. Two is greater than one. And together we can be the greatest in the history of the WWE. I kind of like the sound of that, don't you? Is AJ Styles trying to recruit Finn Balor here? Maybe to the club? I'm not sure what your angle is right now. But I'm going to go on a limb and believe you about wanting to be my partner. I accept. But I'm keeping my eye on you. Finn Balor has just joined the club by the looks of it. It looks like he's aligning here with AJ Styles. And we never thought we'd ever see. We always thought that Finn Balor and AJ Styles were feud over the club. But it looks like they're going to work together. And if AJ Styles, Finn Balor, Gallows and Anderson could all work together, they could be a dominant force here on Mayhem. I know it ain't easy to trust people around here. And look, I ain't saying you should trust me. Don't trust anyone. I could snap at any moment. But for now, I got your back. I got your back, and I will ensure anything, anyone, who goes out for you is sent back into the ground. Hey, interesting. AJ Styles really making a power play here towards Finn Balor. And like I said, that could really create a super faction here on Mayhem. And we ain't doing this alone. We want the WWE Universe behind us. Think about it. With me, him, and all of you, the WWE can finally be great again. Okay, we're going to get a face version of the club here, maybe? Interesting. Very interesting. There we go. Finn Balor and AJ Styles look like they're on the same page here. Very interesting. Was not expecting that at all. Well, straight from that bombshell, we are going to have our first match of the evening. It is going to be Tommaso Ciampa and Johnny Gargano from DIY taking on Edge and Christian in a tag team Tornado Extreme Rules match. And here we go. Now, I said during the Beginnings tournament, I wanted to try and do this a little bit more. Do the tornado-style matches because they're much more stable than the standard tag team matches. And I know it's not necessarily as realistic doing tornado matches every week, but I think it's better. I think it's better for us as well. It means that we're probably going to get a few more normal finishes to tag team matches rather than... Because standard tag matches still aren't working too well. The AI of the non-legal tag team partner is not very good. So having these tornado matches just makes it a lot more easy, I think, for us. And this should be an interesting one. I think the first time I've seen Edge and Christian. And DIY, we've seen once or twice so far. They had a championship match for the tag titles on the first night. Since then, they've not really been involved in the title picture. So I'm assuming that they would love to win this one and get themselves back in the shout for the tag team picture. Of course, the Briscoe brothers did defend the belt successfully against American... Not American Alpha? What am I talking about? They successfully defended them against the Sky Blondes, didn't they, at the beginnings? One of the only teams... One of the only champions in SWE to actually keep a hold of the belts. It's been so difficult to do so for some reason. Nearly every single belt. I think there was only one or two, maybe three belts in the entire company that retained during that pay-per-view. And what is it? There's 10? Is there 10? No, there's 12? Two fours, two twos. Yeah, it's 12 belts. And only about two or three of them were actually successfully retained. I think it was only two. Only two belts were successfully retained, and they were both tag team belts. So I think we're going to try and have maybe one or two more championship matches before Shabby Mania. But Shabby Mania is going to be a little bit sooner. I don't think we're going to get a full 4 weeks out of this, unless I can get ahead of myself. One, two, three. I'm 3 weeks ahead of WrestleMania. So maybe we could get 3 or 4 weeks. That depends. If I can get ahead of myself in recordings, I'll upload a few ahead and we can start to get that done. Shabby Mania probably won't be WrestleMania weekend anyway that it's uploaded, because I'm hoping PJ Toby's going to be coming up here for WrestleMania. He's still trying to confirm if he is, and then we will get some episodes recorded for you guys. I'm sure quite a lot of you have been requested to get PJ Toby. I prefer doing it with two people. I think, I don't know about you guys, but the majority of YouTube channels that I watch are not one person on their own, because I like... just the people bouncing off each other. I like the groups of people. That's why I like watching people like the Yogscast and Neebs Gaming and people like that. That's just a group of people and they have a bit of fun while they're playing it. So, yeah, it would be good to get PJ Toby back for a couple more episodes. And we can make it that special Shabby Mania pay-per-view. And one thing I did want to bring up, actually, is I did mention during the beginning's pay-per-view that after the pay-per-view we would... Wow, that... kendo stick went so far in the air then. We would start to myself and PJ Toby would both get 5 extra picks to bring into our brand. After the first month, we got to sort of understand exactly what we needed and if our roster lacked anything. Unfortunately, I've not been able to get a hold of PJ Toby for a few days, so I've not managed to get his 5 new additions to his roster. So they'll come into effect next week on Mayhem, whereas mine have been done. You will see them on Throwdown or maybe Octane this week. I'll try and get them all debuting at some point. It's going to be quite fun, actually. I've got a few good names on my one. And, of course, I got to steal someone. I get to steal somebody from PJ Toby's roster. So you can have a look at that on Thursday. I'm not going to announce who it is yet. We'll find out on Throwdown. And that person... basically, I got to steal that, if you don't know, because it was Zack Sabre Jr. from my brand who actually won the King of Gladiators tournament. So it means that Zack Sabre Jr. will be challenging Kenny Omega for the Throwdown Championship at Shabby Mania one-on-one. That's been pretty good. Zack Sabre Jr. now is... I don't know how it happened. It sort of snuck under the radar for a lot of people. But Zack now is the Rev Pro All-British Champion. He's the Pro Wrestling Guerrilla Champion. And he is the Evolve Champion as well. He's got 3 of the top belts from the independent scene. So he really is... all out at the moment, isn't he, really? And I just want to bring some up again, just moaning about the game a little bit, but that sort of thing with the weapons being... as Gargano locks in the Gargano escape. Yeah, the weapons reversal is just stupid, isn't it, really? Just back and forth, back and forth. So Gargano's locked in the Gargano escape as Ciampa now have a Project Ciampa on Edge. So Christian does manage to get out of the submission hole, but Ciampa... now finally goes, why the hell did Ciampa wait for Christian to get up before going for the pin? But no, that's only a 2 count as well. But Gargano and Ciampa are DIY. This would be a massive victory for them, sort of against the odds as well. And At that point in time, with both of them locking in their finishes at the same time, it was a possibility, wasn't it? Ciampa now crossbody from the top onto Edge. Be interesting to see where PJ Tovey sees Edge as well. Maybe going for the television championship, but he's good enough to potentially go for the main championship as well, isn't he? We need to find out who is going to be facing Samoa Joe. There's the execution by Edge, and Christian has the pin over on Gargano on the far side, and that's the end. I didn't even see how Christian got the pin on Gargano, to be honest with you, but there we go. Edge and Christian pick up the victory. That's going to raise them up the tag team rankings here on Mayhem, and probably also give a little bit of boost to Edge and Christian in the singles rankings as well. Like I said, I think both these guys potentially could be interested in the television championship, maybe even going a little bit higher, who knows. But there is a big victory there for Edge and Christian. The celebrations are going to go on long for this one, I think. So yeah, we need to find out who's going to face off against the Briscoe brothers at Shabby Mania as well. So maybe that win for Edge and Christian could definitely put them in the spotlight for that one, maybe. Well, it seems our new Mayhem champion here, Samoa Joe, is making his way down to the ring. Of course, Samoa Joe won the belt by defeating CM Punk on night number 4, I think it was, of our beginnings tournament. Be interesting where he's got his mind here. Looking fairly smug, as you would if you just won the Mayhem Championship. I suppose in the brand new improved Mayhem Championship as well, looking a lot better these days. Trust me, I would be angry too if I lived in such a mudhole city like this one. But unlike all of you, I tried doing something about my bad luck. I begged the bosses to let me skip this show, but of course, leaving me out is definitely not best for business. So take your photographs now, because I promise, once I'm out of this ring, I'm getting the hell out of this place. I read that wrong. Today is another city in the long list of days in our uneventful lives. Wow, how fun. We will do everything today like we did yesterday, except this promo. So I guess there's a lot of pressure to be good. Uh-oh. That's a bit of a weird sentence, isn't it, really? I couldn't care less about the politics of this company. I'm not here to be a politician. I'm here to be a superstar, an ass kicker. Love me, hate me, surely you hate me, but this is my time. See the new champion here trying to get really under the skin of the crowd. I don't really care what anyone in the back has to say about it. I care about the authority. If they approve, I'm all good. And I have no doubts they'll approve. Samoa Joe very confident here. Well, that's that. I've said my piece. The actions will start rolling into motion. And once the universe knows you want to do something, it happens. Not the WWE universe, idiots. The actual thing that matters. Haha. Good night. Well, Samoa Joe really making his presence felt here. Sounds like he wanted to skip this show, but he's been forced by the authority. Best for business to have your champion here, I suppose, isn't it? And here we go. Here's our second match of the evening. Daniel Bryan takes on Finn Balor. Looks like Finn Balor's new stablemates, the club, will be at ringside. Let's see how this goes. Could be interesting, this one, because yeah, if what it is correct and Finn Balor has actually joined the club, then that's very interesting. Or is it going to be the sort of situation where the club are playing Finn Balor for a longer goal? We don't often see the club being friendly towards people, do we? But then again, there's a lot of history between Finn Balor, Gallows and Anderson, of course. There wasn't really an overlap. AJ Styles took Finn Balor's position after Finn had joined the WWE. So it's interesting to see just the dynamic between those two. Is there any animosity between those two? Who feels like they are in control of the brand or in control of the stable, shall I say? Or is it all just down for the greater good? With a stable like that, they could definitely divide and conquer Mayhem. They could have all the belts. No reason why not. And of course, talking of the belts, Daniel Bryan won the television championship away from Booker T on night number two of the Beginnings pay-per-view. It was called Ratings War, that night was called. And I think PJ Tovey, although trying to stay impartial, was incredibly happy that Daniel Bryan won that belt. I don't think he was overly keen on Booker T being the champion, but you can't moan. There we go, Booker T, there we go. Here comes the club. So it's... That's very interesting. Seems like Finn Balor's coming out to AJ Styles' music here. And you see Gallows and Anderson slowly coming down the ramp after them as well. All four of these guys coming out to the ring at the same time. This is going to be a very interesting situation, this one. If this works, then we are going to see some serious movement here, some serious dominance in Mayhem. I can't imagine anyone can get in the way of the club. But wait and see what happens. Maybe Daniel Bryan can get in the way of the club right here this evening. The bell goes, we are underway. Finn Balor with AJ Styles, Luke Gallows and Karl Anderson at ringside taking on our current television champion, Daniel Bryan. So I'm drinking my beer. I apologise. I don't. I really enjoy my beer, to be honest with you. Finn Balor sending Daniel Bryan into the ropes, catches him, looking for a slam there, but Daniel Bryan slides out the back. Now, there has been rumours recently that Daniel Bryan is going to potentially leave WWE at the end of his contract and maybe go for one last little run on the independent scene. I'm not entirely sure that I believe that. It came from a comment that was on Talking Smack a couple of weeks back where Miz again was having a go at Daniel Bryan about not wrestling, and Daniel Bryan said that he's not allowed to wrestle, and he said he'll wait and see what happens in a year and a half's time, sort of signaling when his contract ends. I can't honestly see it. I think Daniel Bryan will probably take the doctor's hints on that. Is it really worth risking it? I know he loves wrestling and all that sort of stuff, but is it really worth wrestling? Is it really worth risking the injury that he could possibly cause himself, that could severely damage his body for the rest of his life? Is it really worth that risk? I know some people would potentially go for it, but I'm not sure. I think it was just a passing comment and part of Talking Smack that would just trying to get a response from the Miz and trying to get a response from the crowd. I can't imagine that there's any truth behind it. And I think if there was any truth behind it, I don't think he would have brought it up on Talking Smack to tell the truth. I think he would have kept it very much to himself. But you never know, do you? See, AJ Styles there trying to grab at Daniel Bryan. And I think that little distraction has helped Finn Balor here get control of the match once again. A victory here for Finn Balor, though, you would imagine would probably make him a strong contender for the television championship. Boot in the face there of Daniel Bryan. Now dropping an elbow into the inside of the knee of Daniel Bryan. AJ Styles here, you see, really getting behind Finn Balor, trying to get the crowd revved up as well. Finn taking Daniel Bryan down, now dragging him into the middle of the ring. There's the pin. One, two. It's a bit early, isn't it? And there it is. It's only a two count. As Finn now locking in the head scissors. Elbows to the forehead of Daniel Bryan as well. AJ Styles loving a bit of that. Crowd getting behind Finn as he's just twisting the head. So you can't not get behind Finn Balor, can you? I'm really looking forward to coming back. He did actually wrestle recently. I say recently, I think it was yesterday. He came back as part of a six-man tag match on a live show. It was Finn Balor, Sami Zayn, and Chris Jericho versus Samoa Joe, Triple H, and Kevin Owens. Balor now dropkick into the corner. So that's a good way of getting everyone's fitness up. Triple H needs his fitness for WrestleMania, as does Finn Balor as well. If Finn Balor is going to be worked into a match at WrestleMania, they must know that Finn Balor is an important man to have at WrestleMania, but is there enough time to work him into a match? Maybe Samoa Joe's going to need something to do. So maybe Samoa Joe can take on Finn Balor. But that would end up stealing the night, that match, wouldn't it, really? I don't know. I like Samoa Joe and I like Finn Balor, but I was never a massive fan of their matches together, to be honest. Snap suplex by Finn Balor. But the referee nudged Daniel Bryan's feet underneath the ropes. Now Finn Balor going up top. He hit that big dropkick earlier on, which means he might have a coup de grace in his locker. He does. He's lined it up. Coup de grace on the television champion. There's the pin. One, two, three. Wow. There we go. Finn Balor's reformation with the club has really started off with a massive bang here as Finn Balor gets the pinfall victory. Clean as well, I'll have you know. Nobody from the club got involved in that. It was clean over the television champion. That is interesting, that is. I don't quite understand why some random music's just started up, though. It looks like I've got a bit of work to do on the stable, doesn't it? But I'll get that sorted for next episode. But Finn Balor, massive victory for him. And like I said earlier on, you've got to fancy Finn Balor now, then, potentially, as the number one contender for the television championship after that win. And here comes our next match of the evening. Looks like a little bit of a random one, doesn't it, off the offset? But I think it'll be interesting, too. Very different styles meshing together in the ring. It's going to be Brock Lesnar and Paul Heyman will be at ringside taking on Phoenix. And here we go. The big man, Brock Lesnar. Now, this should be an interesting one because we've seen Phoenix in very similar matches over in Lucha Underground and AAA as well, taking on big brutish forces. And Brock Lesnar is very much of that ilk, but might Brock Lesnar be a bit too much for Phoenix here this evening? It's an interesting one. We've seen Phoenix take on people like Mil Muertes, and Mil Muertes is a big man, probably quite comparable in size to Brock Lesnar, but is he the same sort of beast? That's the question. Lesnar is a very dominant force, but a win here for Phoenix would definitely push him right up the card. Phoenix at the moment sort of classed as a cruiserweight wrestler, but I'm sure he would hope to be classed in a bit of a higher ilk. He don't want to be stuck going for the cruiserweight championship for his entire career. However, it's going to be difficult now with a victory for Finn Balor earlier on. That sort of makes that television championship match very exclusive, doesn't it, really? There's, unless somebody can really stake a claim, maybe get a victory of a Daniel Bryan or a victory of a Finn Balor, you would imagine that television championship match is very much going to be exactly as it is. See Paul Heyman here standing very, very proud of himself as Brock Lesnar is in the ring. I think Heyman's looking incredibly confident here this evening. I don't think he sees much trouble for Brock here with Phoenix, but I'm sure Phoenix, you can't really underestimate him. Like I said, he's a tricky little bugger, and he can catch you out when you're not really paying much attention, can't he, really? He's got that sort of momentum behind him. He's got that high-flying ability that just out of nowhere, he can catch you with quite a high-impact maneuver. And there is the man of the moment, Phoenix, probably getting one of the biggest matches of his career so far here on SWE. And it really is one, like I said, that could really make or break him, really. He could get completely demolished here and get stuck on Octane for the rest of the time, or he could pull off a pretty good victory here and force himself up the card, maybe even to the main event picture of a victory like that. You couldn't say no, could you, really? After beating Brock Lesnar, you've got to really give the guy the props, but we'll wait and see what happens. It really could go either way. It's possible to go either way. However, I've got my opinion that I think who's going to win. And I'm sure most of you would probably agree me with that opinion. But there you go. So Brock Lesnar versus Rey Fenix, as he's now called. Because I think he's left. I think he has left AAA because he's working a lot of the indie scene. He's worked a lot of What Culture Pro Wrestling recently. He's worked a lot of companies across the UK, as well as across America as well, which means we'll probably see a lot more of him now in PWG, which is great because I'm a massive PWG fan, and I really want to see some more of Phoenix. And tell you what, I haven't watched wrestling in so long. The last bit of wrestling I watched was Fastlane, which was an absolute gobshite of a pay-per-view that was. I wish I never bothered with it now, but before that, even, I didn't watch any wrestling a long time. I tried to, but at the moment, I'm just getting stuck with so much with recordings and so forth. However, I have spent 12 hours today, and I've finished recording Fallout 4. I think I'm completely finished the game now, and I've got enough episodes to last us until the middle of April. So that's done now, at least. I can spend a bit less time on the recording, so I can try and catch up with the wrestling, because I've got a few New Japan events I want to watch. There's been some pretty good Ring of Honor stuff going on recently. There's PWG as well, which I want to try and watch. I might watch some PWG this evening. Then again, it is 11 o'clock at night now, and if I put on a 3-hour pay-per-view PWG, I could not get up in the morning. It's Saturday, though. Who cares? It's Saturday tonight, so it's Sunday tomorrow. Then again, I'm enjoying my recordings today. I could do Showdown after this. Brock, massive meat hook clothesline, taking Phoenix down. And I know I've said it quite a few times now, but I just want to reiterate how good the roster for 2K18 is going to be. I think 2K will probably have to cut down the amount of legends because they're more than likely going to have... Well, they're going to have the cruiserweights on there, aren't they? Quite a chunk of them. TJ Perkins, at least. With Cedric Alexander, Noam Dar, Akira Tozawa. They're going to have quite a few. The ones that are working Raw, at least, are definitely going to have to be on there. You've got a few new guys in NXT with Cassius Ohno, Roderick Strong, Eric Young, well, the whole of Sanity, really. A lot of new females on there as well, because all the females they put on there all moved up to the main roster. So Peyton Royce, Billy Kay, Nikki Storm, or Nikki Cross, whatever they call her these days. Ember Moon as well. And of course, they're going to have a few of the British guys, I would imagine they're definitely going to have Tyler Bate on there. He's the British champion, so it just makes sense to have the champion on there, doesn't it, really? And then maybe one or two of the other ones, maybe Pete Dunne's on there, which would be great. If Tyler Bate and Pete Dunne were both on 2K18, I think I would just be very, very happy as Paul Heyman there rocking... Paul Heyman rocking a backflip. Paul Heyman's up on the apron as Phoenix rocking a backflip. Phoenix completely ignoring Paul Heyman. Phoenix now corkscrew moonsault. Can Phoenix pull this off? There's the pin. One, two... Oh my god, he nearly did it. Phoenix nearly defeated Brock Lesnar. That would have been something there. That big splash there. That would have been some victory for Phoenix. That would have been completely outside the box. Brock Lesnar now big clothesline. Referee finally sees the chair that Paul Heyman have thrown into the ring. But now Lesnar is back in control. But Phoenix tripping Lesnar over, playing possum on the ground. Bringing Lesnar back up to his feet. Phoenix now sending Lesnar into the corner. This is not where Lesnar wants to be. But Lesnar fights back with an elbow. And now, there we go. Lesnar going back to his ground and pound. And I think that's the thing with Lesnar. Is every now and again, you can get some offense on him. But eventually, he will turn it around. And then, when Lesnar is in control of matches, you're in a lot of trouble, really. Because he will just completely pick you apart. And here he is now, just stomping on various body parts. Oh, Phoenix now bringing Phoenix back up into a gut-wrench suplex. Lesnar now bringing Phoenix back up to his feet. Gets on the back German suplex against the ropes as well. Now second German suplex. And now the trifecta of German suplexes there by Brock Lesnar on Phoenix. Is that going to be enough? Well, no, Lesnar's going to go for the reverse dragon sleeper hold. A maneuver used in MMA, of course, as well. But used very much in WWE, not necessarily for the submission victory, but maybe just to regain a little bit of energy. But Phoenix breaks free with the elbows to the head. And Lesnar catches him, though, takes him up onto the shoulders. The beginning of the end, and there is the F5. And Lesnar goes straight into the pin here on Phoenix. One, two, and three. There we go. Brock Lesnar picks up the victory. Phoenix put up a very good battle, though. I don't think he got completely hammered like some people expected him to, but he definitely put on a respectable performance there, Phoenix. He had his opportunities where we thought he might be able to pull that one off, but there we go. Brock Lesnar with the dominant victory here on Mayhem. And that is definitely going to build his momentum and push him up the rankings towards the championship as well. And I tell you what, Samoa Joe versus Brock Lesnar will be a very interesting championship match, wouldn't it? I'd like to see that. Wow. Referee really sprung the ropes there when he came out of the ring. Paul Heyman telling his client that it's time to leave now. You don't get paid by the hour. Let's get out of here. And luckily for us here in SWE, Brock Lesnar is allowed to appear more than 4 times a year. And hopefully have a match longer than 26 seconds. I'm so worried about WrestleMania's main event right now. I really am. If Lesnar versus Goldberg can put on a 15-minute match that's quite good, I'd be more than happy. But based on what's happened over the last 12 months... I am not optimistic that Lesnar and Goldberg... Lesnar could put on a 15-minute match, but Goldberg, I think, is really going to struggle. But we'll wait until it happens. It looks like Lesnar's changed his mind. He's making his way back down to the ring with a microphone in hand. Okay. So what's Lesnar got in mind here? Looking fairly confident after a good victory. Looks like Lesnar's got something to say. Is he maybe going to put a claim in? There's a big victory for Lesnar. It's potential that he could be looking for a match against Samoa Joe. It's not the defining victory that would get you a championship match, though, is it? Let's see what he's got to say. I've got something on my mind. You ever have one of those thoughts that you just can't get out of your head? Once you think of it, it just bores at you. Your deepest part of your mind, like a drill. No matter what I do, I can't dig it out. I said a rude word there by mistake, didn't I? Can't dig it out. There's a food chain in the WWE. At the top, the WWE champion. At the bottom is me. And I've been at the bottom far too long. I'm hungry, starving for something more. And I've been getting his nibbles, bites and scraps and leftovers. But now I want the main course. Wow, Lesnar is definitely making a claim for that championship match. I've let myself stagnate in the WWE for too long. I've watched too many other superstars climb the ladder and leave me behind. It's time for a change. It's time for a new me. One who's bolder, faster, better, stronger, and more aggressive. One who focuses on me and my needs. I tell you what, I don't want to see a Brock Lesnar that's more aggressive. That could be very dangerous. Very, very dangerous. I have articulated my concerns with the authority, and they, in their infinite wisdom, are in agreement. Starting now, I will be an emissary of the WWE's bright future by facing anyone who dares defy me or the authority. Is Brock Lesnar aligning here with the authority by the sounds of it? But it looks like it's selling your soul to the devil. Looks like he might get himself some bigger matches coming up. He's not had the best of times so far here in SWE. He's not had a lot to do. Left off of the big card, wasn't he? This is the final straw. No more talk, no more games, no more waiting. Tonight, I either get what I deserve or I begin dismantling this company piece by piece, brick by brick, superstar by superstar. And if you don't believe me, try me. Wow, Brock Lesnar really giving us something to think about here. And leaves the ring. So he's made an ultimatum here. And if he doesn't get what he wants, it sounds like he's going to start taking what he wants. I can't imagine we're going to give him the championship match straight away, though. And here's our next match of the evening. One that the computer set up, and I've decided to keep it because it looks like a pretty cool match. It's going to be Cesaro versus Shawn Michaels in a Falls Count Anywhere match. And here we go, let's rock and roll. Let's see how these two guys get on. Of course, Shawn Michaels probably the bigger name of these two, but Cesaro could really put in a great performance here and step himself up to the next level. Oh, it's so warm in here. I just gone to turn the heater off and it was already off. So Cesaro, somebody that I considered stealing Cesaro from PJ Toby's roster, but I didn't think that I could maybe offer him the same as what he was getting here. I don't know. Not necessarily the same. I don't know how do I explain it. I don't think he's getting offered as much here on Mayhem as what he deserves, but at the same time, I don't think at the moment with the roster the size that I have, with the talent that I have, I don't think I could offer him the same. Potentially maybe, I could have stolen him to put him back in another stable with Chris Hero, couldn't I? But there we go. It's been done now. It has been done. So Cesaro gets a massive match here against Shawn Michaels. And again, this is very much, I won't say make or break, but a win here for Cesaro could really force him up the roster. And a win here for Shawn Michaels could solidify his place in the main event and also boost him up the rankings towards that possible match with Samoa Joe. The more and more people we have on these shows, like, look at the last match. Even Phoenix versus Samoa Joe could have been a very good match. We know Lesnar versus Samoa Joe would be a very good match. Shawn Michaels versus Samoa Joe would be a great match. Cesaro versus Joe would be a great match. As we saw on Raw a couple of weeks ago, there's just so much talent on this roster. And Finn Balor, Daniel Bryan, AJ Styles, even Edge, and Gargano and Ciampa versus Samoa Joe would be great. There's just every single match could be absolutely fantastic. And that's the best thing about this roster, is I can put together some of the most random matches possible that you would not expect to ever see in a WWE ring. And chances are, it will end up being a very, very good match. And this is one of them. Shawn Michaels versus Cesaro. Two different generations, two different styles. But we know it's going to evolve into one great match. And Falls Count Anywhere as well. There's no limitations this one. It could end up in the crowd. It could end up backstage. Hell, it could end up in the middle of the motorway. Who knows? Or the freeway. The freeway. Ah, beer downed. Right. We're good to go. Cesaro straightaway. German suplex. Cesaro, I don't know. I always said that Cesaro, pound for pound, was the strongest wrestler in the WWE. And as much as I still think that's true, of course, Cesaro body slammed Big Show in the very first Andre the Giant Memorial Battle Royal. And also lifted Big Show over the top rope as well. But I think now Braun Strowman, I don't know, is Braun Strowman... See, pound for pound is the phrase, isn't it, really? Braun Strowman's very strong, but he's probably got about 100 pounds over Cesaro. So that would probably mean that Cesaro probably is the stronger out of the two. I don't know, it's interesting, because they were saying that pound for pound, the strongest thing on the planet is an ant. Because an ant can lift like 10 or 20 or 30 times its own weight, whatever it is. So it's all down to what you can lift compared to your own weight. And I think Cesaro has still got to be very high up there. And his finisher, the neutralizer, if you've ever tried to stand in that standing squat position and hold the weight of somebody up, you'll know it's really difficult. Like, I go to the gym quite a bit now. I'm lifting weights and so forth. And yeah, to do what he's doing is just so taxing on the body, especially your legs and your thighs and stuff like that. It's so difficult to do. And you've got to give it to him. The strength he's got and the strength he's gained over the years is incredible. And as you can see by his body, he's very lean. And it's just a shame that he's not been given that brass ring as yet, because I think he does deserve it. The performance he's put on in every single thing he's been given has always been fantastic. The crowd are behind him. He's one of the best sort of... He's one of the best underrated faces they've got at the moment, WWE. And I don't know, they seem to have this sort of problem. Like, I was reading a couple of days ago that the idea was to have Luke Harper join the Randy Orton and... Bray Wyatt main event at WrestleMania. That was the original plan. Vince McMahon said no because he did not feel that Luke Harper was good enough to be in the main event at WrestleMania. So instead of giving us a Wyatt family triple threat, he's given us Bray Wyatt, who's a very fresh new world champion and really enjoying his championship reign, against a drug-rattled man who can't wrestle for an entire year without getting injured for half of it, Randy Orton. Now, I've got no problem with Randy Orton. I think he's all right, but I think it's just a bit boring, isn't it, really? When you've got the talent you have and they're trying to sell us the new generation of wrestling, that's the most frustrating thing. Over the last couple of years, we've heard the new generation of wrestling, the new generation of this, and all of a sudden, the main event of WrestleMania is going to be Lesnar versus Goldberg. It's like, what happened to the new generation of wrestling? AJ Styles is taking on Shane McMahon. Again, just not really the new generation. You've got the new generation of wrestling. Kevin Owens lost his championship so that Goldberg versus Lesnar could be the main event at WrestleMania. Well, how does that make the new generation of wrestlers feel? To be there day in, day out, wrestling live shows across the entire world, and then Goldberg turns up, wrestles less than a minute in 6 months, gets given the championship and the main event at WrestleMania. It's crazy, isn't it? As this match now... into the crowd, Shawn Michaels crunching the arm of Cesaro, another headbutt as well. Where are these two guys going now? Looks like they can squeeze down there. I didn't think they could there for a second. There we go. Shawn Michaels and Cesaro now fighting through the crowd. These guys who weren't too happy with their tickets at the beginning of the night, thinking they had a bit of a distance to see, are now right in the thick of it as now Shawn Michaels and Cesaro out onto this concrete area. There's quite a big open space here to fight in. Oh, and out of nowhere, Sweet Chin Music by Shawn Michaels. Drops into the pin. Where's the ref? Oh, where's the referee? Come on, ref. One, two. Oh, and it's only a two count. I reckon if the ref had got there a bit quicker, then Shawn might just have had this match won there. Where's the referee going now? Why is he running away for? Ref, stay there in case somebody else pins him. Oh, this game's crazy, isn't it? This game is crazy. It's almost like they didn't test half of it before they actually released it. Cesaro, big German suplex now on Shawn Michaels. Nearly called him Shane Michaels there for some reason. Double foot stomp though by Cesaro, who's getting himself back into this one as this fight's now continued round to the side of the ramp. Oh, Cesaro sending Shawn Michaels headfirst into the concrete. I think it looks like there's a little bit of matting out there, but it's not going to be very good matting. It's literally less than an inch thick. It's not good at all. As this match continues on, neckbreaker by Shawn Michaels on Cesaro. And where's Michaels going now? I thought he might continue the assault, but Michaels is disappearing round. Up he goes. Why is Shawn not going for the pin? He's just left Cesaro there. It's a false count anywhere, and Shawn's going all the way back to the ring. Is he looking maybe to get himself a weapon? Is that what he's looking for? No, he's back in the ring now. This is very bizarre decisions there by Shawn Michaels. Now Cesaro gets himself back up on the ramp, and I think Shawn thought this match was done, but now Cesaro sprinting back down the ramp towards Shawn. Shawn can't believe it. He thought Cesaro was done and dusted then. Oh, and now Shawn looking to lock in a sharpshooter middle of the ring. Oh, Cesaro managed to fight his way all the way back into the ring, but the damage done to his back on the outside might just cause him to tap out here. Or is it? Cesaro, no, manages to roll through. Of course, Cesaro, former tag team partners with Tyson Kidd. He's used to seeing that maneuver quite a lot. The sharpshooter, there's the very European uppercut there by Cesaro. And again, another bizarre decision. Rather than going for the pin after that big signature move, he goes to taunt the crowd. Now Shawn Michaels slowly back up to a kneeling base. Cesaro now getting on the back of Shawn. Half and half suplex. Half dragon suplex, half German. Now Cesaro looking to line up Shawn Michaels. This would be a massive win here for Cesaro. Takes him up. Neutralizer. Cesaro could do this here. Rolls over Shawn Michaels. One, two. Oh my God, Shawn Michaels kicked out. That could have been massive, that victory there for Cesaro. That would have given Vince no choice but to just wedge that brass ring right on Cesaro's finger. Cesaro now into a suplex. Stomping right on the ribcage there of Shawn. And then as Shawn was clutching his ribs, Cesaro was stamping on the stomach. Now Shawn fighting back, sending Cesaro into the corner. Shawn now again just taunting away rather than attacking Cesaro. Dad does catch him with that overhand punch. Maybe I'm giving Shawn a bit of hassle there when he didn't deserve it. Snake eyes on Cesaro. And then into a running forearm. And I think Cesaro's actually been busted open from that snake eyes. Shawn scoop slam. Yes, Cesaro has been busted open. Shawn bringing Cesaro back up to his feet. And again, looking for that sharpshooter. Shawn looking to get the submission victory again. Dead center of the ring. Cesaro busted open. Can he survive? No, he doesn't. Unfortunately for Cesaro, he does tap out. And Shawn Michaels picks up the victory here on Mayhem. It was a very interesting match, and Cesaro had a very good opportunity to win that one as well, just like Phoenix in the previous match. Just when you think there's a good opportunity, your favourite comes back and just shows why he was the favourite to start off with. Shawn Michaels now taunting the crowd. big victory for him. And that's going to force him up the rankings a bit. Again, we've not done much with Sean so far. Big name. And there's a lot of people here this evening really shouting up for a championship match, isn't there, really? This is Brock Lesnar backstage, getting right in the face of The Undertaker now. We heard Brock Lesnar say, oh my god, Taker just took him out. We heard Lesnar saying earlier, if he doesn't get what he wants, then he's going to have to start taking it. It looks like he is starting here on The Undertaker backstage. Now, if you do want to make an impact, taking on The Undertaker is definitely a way to do it. Interesting, Lesnar just assaulting him backstage now and continuing the assault. There's a backbreaker. So Paul Heyman nowhere to be seen. I love the way the guys in the background just completely ignore the hell what's going on. Lesnar now getting around the back of Taker, looking potentially for some Germans, but Taker fighting back. Oh, DDT. Lesnar hit hard there. Taker now sending Lesnar straight into the locker room. Taker really struggling to use the door there, but he seems to have fixed it now. Stamping on the gut of Brock Lesnar as well. And Lesnar might be regretting his decision now to attack Undertaker backstage. You see what Lesnar's trying to do? If you want to make an impact, taking on someone like The Undertaker is definitely a way to do so. But has he bitten off a bit more than he can chew here? Looks that way. Taker chokeslam backstage on Brock Lesnar. And he's not even finished there. Bringing Lesnar back up to his feet. Oh, Lesnar fighting back though. Lesnar sort of chokeslammed in the locker room and he's fighting back. Oh, but he gets launched over the top of Taker's back and Lesnar drops back first on the carpeted area. Like carpet's going to really protect you too much from the concrete ground. Taker now just walking round Lesnar now. Taker bringing Lesnar back up to his feet. Taker now sending Lesnar into... Wow, that wooden strut in between two of the locker areas. And I think Lesnar's greatly regretting his decision here to try and make an impact on The Undertaker. Taker bringing Lesnar up. Oh, Lesnar does fight back though. Elbow to the face of Taker. Oh, went for a suplex, but Taker reversed it into like a crossbody. Taker is really no selling any of Lesnar's stuff here this evening. Oh, and Taker has Lesnar once again. Chokeslam in the locker room. And still, Taker's not finished. Taker wants to send a message here himself. Sending, oh, Lesnar straight into the television screen. Go on, do it. We've not seen any interactive stuff with the locker room so far. Do it, Taker. Why do they just stand there and stare all the time? This is on Legend difficulty. I don't understand why they just stand there and stare. Come on, Taker, you could have put Lesnar straight through the TV by now. Lesnar still shaken. And Taker still just stood there doing nothing. Come on. There we go. Now Taker does start to strike again. Oh my god, Taker. Not back. Oh my god, Taker just tombstoned Brock Lesnar in the locker room. And I think Taker's happy with the work he's done now. Brock Lesnar tried to make an impact here. And it seems to have very much backfired. And here we go with another really random match that the computer has created for us. And that is going to be this triple threat between Stone Cold Steve Austin, CM Punk and Bret Hart. Again, like I said, it's a random one, but you know what? I bloody like it, so let's go for it. So here we go, main event of the evening. And it's going to be a good one. The former Mayhem champion here, CM Punk, back in the mix, looking to try and get himself back in that championship picture. Of course, he defeated Samoa Joe on night number one of the Universe mode, but Samoa Joe returned the favor with a victory on night number four of our beginnings pay-per-view. And CM Punk really needs to get himself back into it now. It's difficult for him because that loss was quite convincing, wasn't it? And that's the worrying thing for CM Punk. He needs to turn this around. He needs to get himself really just back to exactly where he should be at the top of the card. But he got a little bit embarrassed there, to be honest with you. And this is a great chance when you've got the likes of... When you've got the likes of Bret Hart and Stone Cold Steve Austin in the ring with you, you really are creating a very dominant position, aren't you? If you can pick up a victory here this evening, you are skyrocketed straight away. Any one of these three guys is definitely going to end up in the top five of the ranking, surely, with a victory like this. Dude. We're not seeing much of Austin so far in this universe mode, have we? It's quite funny the other day, right? My dad has never watched wrestling his entire life. And I was down visiting for the weekend. And I walked into his living room and he was watching a program. And I could hear a voice that I recognised. And it ended up that he was watching, I think it was Dave. And Stone Cold Steve Austin's got his own TV program on. And my dad, who's never watched wrestling before, was just watching this program. No idea who it was. Which I thought was pretty cool. The fact that's on in the UK now as well shows how good the program was. But then again, Dave gets all... Well, I love Dave. Dave's my favourite TV station on UK television. It just has everything that's on Dave. It's just programmes that I like. There's very rarely anything on there that I'm not keen on. But there you go. I really fancy playing some Age of Empires 2. I really do. I've not played it in so long. I've literally not played it in 20 years. It was one of the first PC games I ever had. And I really want to play it again. And they've recently re-released it in HD. And they've got two new expansion packs that have been released over the last couple of years as well. So I think I'm definitely going to get hold of that. And I'll probably do some videos on my channel. I know it's completely random. But if there's anyone out there that's roughly my age range, you'll probably love Age of Empires as well. My problem is that I brought so many games on Steam this month. I need to hold back. Because I won a lot of money earlier in the month. I did a football bet on my payday. I bet £5 on a bet that was 200 to 1. And I won it, so I got a grand. And I've been spending frivolously ever since. On some really... I brought bloody Farming Simulator. I had so much money, I brought frickin' Farming Simulator. I don't even know why. But then again, my two-year-old nephew had a great bit of fun driving a tractor around a farm. He loved that, so got some use out of it once, I suppose. Bell goes. I'll stop talking crap now. We are underway. Austin and Brett. A famous rivalry between those two. I want to say WrestleMania 15. I'm probably completely wrong, but I want to say WrestleMania 15 was when Brett took on Austin. And did Austin lose the match, but he didn't tap out? He ended up being knocked out? That sounds about right. Austin now all just dropping Brett on the back of his neck. Front chancery into a knee to the face of Punk. And that's the tricky thing now of a triple threat match. You literally have to keep your eyes over your shoulder the whole way through the match, because as soon as you get ahead there like Austin, you've got someone behind you. And same here for Brett. Brett takes Austin down, but now CM Punk's there. Oh, but Brett takes CM Punk down now as well, by the looks of it. Front chancery into a neck breaker. And what a great ritual this would be for Bret Hart. He's been a little bit non-existent so far on our Mayhem roster. And I don't know why the game decided only to give us five matches. The problem is I put it in for seven matches per show. And that includes, that gives us five matches for the show and two dark matches. But it seems to be that if the game creates a promo, it counts the promo as a match. Which is fine, but you can't cancel the promo and get your match back, which is a bit annoying. So, yeah. Now that we're actually doing feuds properly in this universe mode, it's a bit more awkward, because there's going to be a lot more promos. And I might try and do some of my own promos as well at some point, but so far I don't think the promos this evening have been too bad on the game. They've sort of made sense. And they've sort of been effective in what we've seen. We've seen, obviously, AJ Styles recruit Finn Balor to the club. We've seen Samoa Joe talking himself up, of course, our new Mayhem champion. And then Brock Lesnar demanding something more. And if he doesn't get what he wants, he's going to go out there and take it. And that's what he did here by attacking The Undertaker previous to this match. However, that sort of backfired and Undertaker destroyed Brock Lesnar backstage. So be interesting to see what comes out of that as well. Austin now dragging Bret Hart into the middle of the ring. CM Punk's down on the outside. One, two, only a two count. We're looking like time-wise, so we're over an hour. Wow, it's not been very often been over an hour on a five-match episode, is it? But it's all been pretty good content, actually. I'm pretty happy with how this episode of Mayhem is going. And, of course, if you guys are as well, then there's always that nice little thumbs-up button down below. that you can press. It does. I'm not gonna just ask likes for the sake of it, but basically, when you do like a video, it boosts the video up the algorithm. So it means that if someone does search for WWE 2K17 Universe Mode, this video goes higher and higher up the list. Of course, there's quite a lot of big competition that does this sort of thing. So at the moment, we're quite difficult to find unless you're already here. So the more likes we get, and the more subscribes, and the more views the video gets, the higher it goes up the search function. It sort of snowballs, I think. That's the way it works. But yeah, like I say, I'm not doing it for money. You can't earn money off this stuff anyway. 2K do not allow you to earn money off of their games, which is annoying because I could earn a decent amount. But there you go. There's a pin by Austin after the stunner. Wow, Punk decided to go there very, very late. But luckily, Brett kicked out. Punk now sending Austin into the corner. Yeah, it's pretty annoying, really, though. 2K do not allow you to monetize the videos. Every other game company, apart from Nintendo, I think every other games company allows you to do it. I don't think there's many. I think there's the odd one or two here and there, but I think 2K are the major one. It seems very odd to me because I can't understand why it would affect them. It's not like we're taking money away from them, is it, really? That's the only thing. But to say it doesn't really matter, it just, if I was earning more money off the channel, then I would invest that money in the channel. As you can see, by some of the stuff here recently, I've invested in a new bit of channel art and a new logo. And obviously, I've, as said in previous times, as you probably will know, I am awful at creating stuff myself. I'm not very artistic. So I've been buying work from graphic designers and so forth, and I'm spending a lot of money out of my own pocket. Out of this grand that I won, I probably spent about, on new games and the artwork and so forth, I spent about 120 quid this month so far on my YouTube channel. And I'm not really supposed to tell people this, but I got paid £1 this month from YouTube. That's all I got. So, yeah, it would be nice if 2K would let you get paid from it, but it doesn't really matter, does it? I say, I do this for fun anyway. If there was nobody watching, I'd still be making the same videos. So, you know, it is what it is. Only a 2 count. And Punk comes straight in the ring with a little taunt. Austin now sending Punk into the turnbuckle. So going for here now, sending Punk straight across into the far turnbuckle. Punk avoids the oncoming Austin. Sorry, I was having a drink. And drops him in a side effect and then grabs the arm and wrenches it back. But Bret Hart was back up on his feet and kicking straight into CM Punk. Punk now sending Bret across the ring. And Punk sending Bret across the other side now. Runs in. Big knee to the face. Followed up by the running bulldog. No. Bret reverses the bulldog and sends Punk landing flat on his back. And now Bret sending Punk into the corner. Austin's completely out of the match at this point in time. Bret now big chop to the neck of CM Punk. There's the pin. One, two. Oh, Austin didn't get there in time and Bret Hart got the win. Wow, I'm surprised. And Punk, I think, I'm sorry Punk, but you've just dropped again, haven't you? You've just dropped again. That is not very good work at all by CM Punk. Lost the championship at Beginnings a few days ago and now giving up quite a cheap win here to Bret Hart as well. And that's going to rocket Bret further up the rankings. Say, Bret's not really done much so far in the Universe Mode, so I don't think that's going to guarantee him a championship by any stretch of the imagination, but it's definitely going to get him very much back in the picture. So guys, that's the end of this episode of SWE Mayhem. I hope you have enjoyed it. Of course, if you have, like I said earlier on, hit that nice little thumbs up down below. And of course, if you are new around here and you would like to see some more, then you can hit that subscribe button as well. And I don't know, this is new to me as well, but apparently if you press the subscribe button again, there's a little bell there or something around it. It gets you a nice little a notification if you want to know whenever I upload a video. I've done it to quite a few of my favourite YouTubers now because it's nice to know exactly when a video's up. So if you want to do that, you can do that. I think it's next to the subscribe button. There's a little bell and it gives you a nice little nudge when there is a video there to go. I've been Shabby Gamer. Thank you very much for watching and I'll see you in a couple of days' time for our next episode of Showdown. Bye 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 b